Hi, I recently wrote a blog post about Azure Storage. I wanted to show how easy it is to work with and the fact that you can debug and test it locally without even having an Azure subscription. What I'm going to do in this video is walk through the blog post step by step, follow along exactly as it's written, and show you hands-on how to build and debug an Azure Functions or a serverless application using Azure Storage and then deploy it to Azure. My name is Jeremy Lickness. I'm a cloud developer advocate with Microsoft. Let's get started. Starting with Visual Studio 2017, I'm going to select the Azure Functions template. This will open a dialog for me that allows me to enter a name for the application. So I'll type in the name and then leave Create Directory for Solution checked and click OK. Now I have a dialog that allows me to enter an initial trigger, select my framework, choose my storage account and access rights. We're going to make this anonymous and use our local storage emulator. This will spin up the project. The first thing I want to do is take the Function1 class and rename it to something more useful. In this case, we'll call it Link Shortener. Now that we have it renamed, we can paste in the code from the article that basically refactors the method provided to use an href instead of a name. The trigger by default just echoes a name back, but we're building a link shortener. So the first test is, can we echo an href that we passed in the query string back? So we've tested this code. We're going to go ahead and hit debug. And this is going to launch the Function App host. It's a fully functional host for Function App endpoints that's cross-platform, so this will run on any machine. And here it's found the endpoint for the function. So I'm going to copy that endpoint, navigate to a web browser, and paste that in. And the first time I'll get a message that says I should enter a URL. So I'm going to go ahead and add the href parameter and default this for the first attempt to my blog and hit enter, and it should echo back that I passed in the blog. For the link shortener functionality to work, we need to add a few classes. The first class is a key that simply keeps track of a next up identifier so that we can generate the code for the link shortener. So this is a very simple class. It inherits from table entity, which is what we use for table storage, so that has some partition key and row key and timestamp information. And what's unique for us is the identifier. Next, we'll create a URL data class that holds the long URL that we're mapping to, as well as a count of times that that URL was referenced. Now we'll add some bindings to our method. The first binding will map to a specific table entry and pull in that key entry for us so that we get the next up ID. The second entry is a generic way to interact with table storage. That's all that it takes to make the interaction. If we don't have a key yet, we'll initialize it to a new value and insert it so that it is available for later use. Now we'll go ahead and remove the return value because we're going to change that to the short code and add the logic to create the code. Basically, there's a mapping of the integer to alpha text. Then we create a new entity that has a partition key, which is the first character of the code itself, the long URL, and a count, which will initialize to zero and update as users navigate. The final steps are to increment the key and replace it in the table, then insert the new URL, which is the mapping from the short code to the long code, and then we return that short code to the browser. Let's go ahead and save that and jump into debug and see this working in the browser. So I'm going to basically refresh this page now that the storage code is there, and as you can see, we get a short code returned back to us. Next, I'm going to use a feature built into Visual Studio called Cloud Explorer that'll allow me to navigate to the local storage emulator and take a look at what I've actually stored in my Azure storage table. And this is locally on my developer machine. So I expand tables, navigate to the URLs table, which was created for me automatically the first time I inserted a row. And there you can see I have the key that's incremented the ID, as well as the shortcode BNK that maps to the blog. Now that we have the ability to create a short URL, we need a new function to actually navigate. So this function has a route that takes the short URL as part of the route, and we're going to give it the function name go so that we can go to the short URL. Within the parameters for this, we've got the table so that we can access the table storage, and we've also mapped part of the route to the short URL parameter. I've also added a queue. What I want to do is redirect as quickly as possible, and so I'm going to output the value of the short code to the queue so that I can update the count later. The code basically accesses the URL data. If it has a match, it adds the short code to the queue, and then it responds with a redirect. So let's take a look at that code in action. We're going to launch debug again, and this time we've got a new set of APIs. We've got set and go. So I'm going to change the URL after I add a new link. This is a developer advocates link, and I'll get back a new code that's BNL. And then on the API, I'm going to switch it from set to go, add the BNL to the end, and hit enter. And what it should do is pick up the record and redirect me to the advocates page. Now keep in mind that it did that quickly so that we did not update the count yet. Instead, we stored it in this queue that was automatically created for us. And here you can see the short code inside that queue. The next step is to add the code that'll process the queue. So we paste that in, and there's basically a queue trigger that points to the queue name, a table trigger or a table binding that points to the table name. And it's a very simple operation. The table's accessed based on the short code. If a result is found, the count is incremented, and then that table entry is replaced. We don't have to add anything new because the queue already has an entry in it, so we'll just go ahead and debug. And what you'll see after it starts running is that process counts that's processing the queue executed because there was an entry in the queue from before. So we'll go into our Cloud Explorer and refresh the queue, and we see that the entry has been removed from the queue. Next, we'll go to our table and refresh the table, and you can see that the developer advocates entry has been incremented with a count of 1 because it's been accessed one time. Now that our program is complete, let's go ahead and publish it to Azure. So I right-click and choose Publish. I'm going to create a new function app. I've got to give the app a unique name, and this is unique across all of Azure. I give it a subscription, put it inside a resource group. I can create a new one or pick an existing. And I also pick an app service plan, and this indicates how that function app is going to scale. So I just picked a basic plan. When I click create, what it's going to do is deploy these resources to Azure. So the first step is creating the app service plan and the function app so that it's ready to receive the code. Once those are created along with a backing storage account, the project is built, and then the project assets are deployed to the cloud. Now I can copy the endpoint to the clipboard, navigate to my web browser, and perform the same thing. First, I'll access the API and set it, this time to my GitHub repo that contains this code, so we get the short link BNK. Next thing I'll do is access the Go API, pass the short code, and confirm that it indeed redirects me to my repository. We'll navigate to short link, and that's a wrap.